Being a mom has been one of my greatest joys, but also biggest challenges. And if I'm being honest, in this short time of being a mother to my beautiful daughter, I have learned so much. I am Jamila Yarbrough. Join me as I sit down with some of my amazing sisters as we discuss the lessons we learn navigating being mothers, wives, business owners, and women of faith. Today's guest is my dear sister, Denisha Pratt. She is a wife, mom, actress, author, and publisher. Denisha, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you.
I love you so much. You are an amazing sister. You are someone that I admire. I love the way you are just a wonderful mother and wife and one of my favorite actresses. You are a girl. I'm a fan.
Thank you.
And writer, publisher, like the list goes on and on, you know? But what I love the most is just how you love the people around you, how you literally are an extension of God's love to those that you encounter. And I just adore you. I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful that you're in my life, and I'm grateful to have you here today.
Oh gosh.
So thank you.
You're blessing me so much. Like, thank you. Thank you. You know how much I love you. Thank you.
Yes. And I think what's funny, you know, the way we met.
Yep.
So we met, I don't know, what year was that?
It was 2014. It was when we first, right when we moved here.
Yes.
Right when we moved here.
Yeah. So you guys had just moved here from North Carolina. Was it from, no.
Philadelphia by way of North Carolina. Like we were coming from Philly. Yes. It just took a really short little let's soak up all of our family before coming here.
Yes.
So Philadelphia by way of North Carolina. Mm-hmm.
And so I had been here for a few years by then.
Yeah.
And I was at Trader Joe's, and I think I was buying some wine, and your husband, Chris, saw my ID and was like, what's it say in North Carolina?
Yes.
You guys lived in Greensboro.
In Greensboro. And he had worked in Winston-Salem at one point.
Yes. And we just started talking, and he talked so much about you, and we realized that we had worked with mutual people.
Yeah.
And he was like, you need to meet my wife.
Yes. Which is, the weirdest thing before. I was like, babe. To tell someone, you should meet my wife.
Like, right. Looking back, I was like, oh, yeah, that was kind of weird.
That's kind of weird.
But at the time, I didn't even think about it that way. It's so funny.
Yeah.
And so then we connected. Mm-hmm. He connected us. Mm-hmm. And we finally met at a coffee shop.
Yeah.
And I met my beautiful godchildren that day.
They were babies.
They were so little. Mm-hmm. And from that day on, we've been each other's lives.
Yes.
I just remember us talking, and you were so open and vulnerable, and we just connected right away.
Yeah.
And literally from that day on.
That was it. I know I was crying. I'm crying now. I know there were tears. We really connected. And I'm so grateful for that day and that time and that we were able to connect in that. God used Chris to open his mouth to say that and to bring you through his life. All the things that had to fall into place. You know, what if you didn't go to that Trader Joe's? What if you're like, I'm going to go to a different grocery store? Just all the things.
And Chris is so right. Here we are.
Yeah. He was right.
Yes. You know, so I adore your children. They are such a big part of my heart. I am just the proudest godmommy, and they are just incredible kids. Like, I'm in awe of them, honestly. And you know how certain children will give you confidence of the future? They give you confidence of the future. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, we're going to be good because they are here, you know? Their light is so bright. They are so loving and so giving and so empathetic. And so they're just and wise beyond their years, you know?
Yeah.
And just talented and just great kids, you know? They, yeah. I love being around them, you know, as a family, we adore being around them.
Yeah.
And, you know, so kudos, Mama. Kudos.
Listen, thank you. But it's such a responsibility because they are the way that God has made them.
Mm-hmm.
And there's so many times where I'm like, Lord, I need you to help me because I'm like, I don't want to mess up because they are so all the things that you said and more. When I was pregnant with Declan, I remember we were on our baby moon in Nashville, Tennessee.
Hey.
And the whole time I was walking around with Declan, I was pregnant, and I told Chris, I feel like I'm carrying royalty.
Mm-hmm.
I kept saying that. I'm sure other moms might feel something like this, but there's something about, there's something about him. I don't know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And we went to a grocery store in Nashville, and there was this older gentleman was bagging, and he kept staring at me from several registers down, and it was a little uncomfortable. And when we were leaving, we had to walk past him, and he stopped me, and he like blessed my pregnancy, and he called Declan a king, and it was. I looked at Chris and like, did you just hear what he's? This is literally what I've been saying. I feel like I'm carrying royalty.
Yes.
He's been staring at me and he called him a king.
Yes.
And so there's been, it's just been, I've known there's something very special about them. And
yes.
I need all the help and all the wisdom that I can get from God to be a good mom to them because they've been entrusted to us. And
yes.
So there's a lot of weight that yes. comes with that.
Yes.
And then there are times I have to remember they're also going to have their moments of just being a 10-year-old and just being a 9-year-old and like having their fits. But because there are times where they're so wise and they are very mature and they carry themselves well, it kind of throws me off sometimes when they do things that just a normal 10-year-old. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's yeah, right. I forget. Okay, all you right, are 10.
Yeah. yeah. All right, you're just in a mood.
Right.
All right. Okay, you're hangry. That's right.
Right.
Just a real thing with Declan.
You know, one of the things you said is the fear of getting it right.
Yeah.
That resonates with me.
Mm-hmm.
As a mom, it's like one of the first things, honestly, I've experienced was like, okay, I want to do right by this little one that God has entrusted me with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what have you done or what do you do with that fear of wanting to get it right?
One of the things is I pray a lot, but it's not, Lord Jesus, it's not always like, Lord Jesus, guide me. And sometimes it's in the moment, Lord, I need your help right now.
Yes.
Like, I don't think I'm doing this right. You know, I'll tell them when I'm afraid. I've tried being more real with them about, like, listen, mom's having a really hard time right now. I'm trying to express my emotions to them more. I'm very frustrated with this right now, so I just need you to give me a minute.
Mm-hmm.
By me saying it out loud, I hear myself, and then it's kind of, it kind of snaps me out of it for a moment to... Whereas other times I would have just been in my head.
Right.
And the more I just stay in my head with it, it would just fester and turn into something else. And then, like, if I'm afraid that I'm going to mess up or that I yelled at them and now all these things, now I'm going to make them have to go to therapy. Therapy's a great thing. But, like, those are things, like, what did I do now that's going to cause a problem for them down the road? What did I just say is the one thing they'll remember that my mom always said? So I'll go back once I've calmed down and talk to them.
Yes.
If it's Declan or if it's Karis, whoever I hurt in that moment, whoever I feel I may have possibly crushed something. there was one day I told Declan, I was frustrated because I kept asking them to help with things, and Karis is more than willing to help. She has such a servant's heart.
She does.
Anything she can do to help, yes. It just comes naturally to her.
Yes.
It doesn't come as naturally to Declan. Mm-hmm. And I said, I don't want you to be, you're starting to become lazy, and I don't want you to be lazy. I don't want to raise a lazy son.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw what that did to him, and then I replayed it in my head, but I was frustrated because this is not just a one day thing. This has been day after day after day, and months after months, like, make your bed, pick this up. Can you help? You know, can somebody help? Karis is right there to help. He's willing to let other people do other things for him sometimes. And then I sat down and talked to him the next day, and it was like, hey, I just want to let you know, I wasn't calling you lazy.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't saying that you are a lazy person. I just don't want you to pick up lazy habits that will be harder to break when you get older, that will turn you into a lazy person.
Right.
It's like, I'm not calling you that. And then to see him go, okay. So in those, that's what's helping me realize.
Yes.
This is how I can, even if I mess up, I can go and talk to them after.
That's good.
And that's the opportunity to correct it it can turn into something else. That he's not like 10 years down the road, he's got in his head, my mom called me lazy. My mom called me lazy. Because I don't want to put that curse on him. I don't want to put that on him.
Right.
But because I was frustrated that he didn't run to come help or didn't do what I asked him, he didn't make his bed, now I've caused a problem down the road that he's going to have to deal with for years. My mom called me lazy.
Yes.
We nipped it in the bud.
Yeah.
That's and we cleared
so
it up.
So good, though. One of the things that you're highlighting is the ability to look at yourself and say, I did not do that right. Yeah. Humble yourself.
Yeah.
And go to your child. Because so often, especially I feel like in a lot of our generation, the dynamic was not so much to go to your child and apologize and say, hey, I didn't do that right. Mm-mm. I'm sorry. I made you feel XYZ.
Yeah.
I shouldn't have said that.
Mm-mm.
I should have said this, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And to even hear what that shift for him in that moment, that you humbling yourself and going before him, you know, then that becomes a moment of empowerment, because not only is he getting such a great example of humility, mm-hmm. as well as, it's okay if I make a mistake.
Yeah.
And this is how you correct it.
Because
we're going to do that.
We're going to do that.
Make mistakes. But how do you own up to it? And how do you still go back to the person and make it a moment that someone can gain from,
mm-hmm.
versus the opposite?
Yeah.
You know?
Yes.
It's such a great example.
Yes. And one thing that also helps me is, yes, you've only been on this planet for 9 or 10 years,
mm-hmm.
right? But you were with God a lot sooner ago than I was.
Yes.
They're coming, we belong to him. You belong to him before you belong to me, before he gave you to me.
Mm-hmm.
So there's, when you spoke of, there's a wisdom.
Yes.
They had that already.
Yes.
So I have to be able to listen when they're telling me things,
mm-hmm.
when they see things,
mm-hmm.
because they're coming from a different perspective. They don't have to worry about bills. They don't have to worry. They haven't had to deal with all the extra distractions that the world can give us.
Right.
Right?
Right.
So they can pick up on things a lot easier,
mm-hmm.
than I may be able to.
Yes.
So, but I have to be able to be, I need to be quick to listen.
Yes.
Even if it's coming from a 9-year-old,
yes.
I need to be quick to listen.
Yes.
And that's, I'd rather hear from, because there's, I mean, it's like you're saying that children are seen but not heard, mm-hmm. you know, what do you know? I've been here longer. You're not going to tell me how to do things. It's like, no, they know what's going on.
Yes.
They have a different perspective. They have a much more pure perspective.
Yes. I think that's so good because, yes, you set boundaries, and, yes, mm-hmm. they understand who is the parent, who
yes.
is the child.
Mm-hmm.
But there is this ability, this ability to have a relationship where mm-hmm. you're both learning and you're both mm-hmm. saying, yeah, I'm figuring this thing out too, yeah. you know?
Yes.
And you can grow, you can both be growing
yes.
in that way. And I think that's wonderful. What do you think are some of the greatest lessons you've learned from each of them?
Karis is really great about getting me to sit down and rest. I'm so grateful for her because I'll just go and go and go and go and go, go, go. And then, Mom, sit down. No, I'm good. Let me just do it. She will physically grab me, mm-hmm. bring me, and sit me down. You know,
yes.
like you need to rest.
Wow.
So she's teaching me how to rest. I mean, and also for her to be perceptive enough to see right. that Mom is doing this, this, and this. Right. And she told me, I appreciate all that you do. What? You're not even supposed to be aware of it. And wow. that's what brings me back to God help me, because there's something... You're not supposed to be aware of what your
yes.
parents do. You're 9 and 10 years old. This yes. is the time you're supposed to be the most oblivious, you know? Just go about your... But to see that. And Declan's really teaching me to choose my words carefully.
Mm-hmm.
He's a great reminder that our words really do have weight.
Yes.
Because to see... We as parents have such a... I don't want to use the word power, but we do have the power to just crush them with our mm-hmm. words oh so easily.
Right. To crush or empower.
To crush or empower.
Yeah. Yes.
And it's, so he's really teaching me to
mm-hmm.
be very careful with my words.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's good.
Mm-hmm.
So tell me, what does letting go or surrender mean to you? Because I will say, one of the greatest lessons I've been learning
mm-hmm.
is in that,
yeah.
is in letting go and surrender.
Yes.
And I'm curious of what that means to you.
I feel like it changes. It evolves
yes.
a lot.
Yes.
There's
many like you think you know,
yep.
you think you let it go mm-hmm. or learn surrender, and then it's like, oh, it's a new level to this.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like, oh, that's still there. That's yeah. still right there.
Yes.
to me, surrender means, I mean, yes, letting go, but I've been in such a place of surrender in many areas of my life recently
mm-hmm.
that I feel to the point where I physically have to do this
uh-huh.
as a reminder of
yes.
I let it go. I'm not gonna pick it up. And it's not even I'm doing this so I can praise God. It's
just
for me, I just need to have that visual and to feel it.
Yes.
To feel that I have released it.
Yes.
I'm not going to pick that up. I see it there. I'm not gonna pick it up.
Mm-hmm.
But then while my hands are like this, then I can go, all right.
Yeah.
Then I can go up.
Yes.
Then I can give it to God and
yes.
and say, I put it at your feet. And there are times I have to keep reminding myself. And that's why that physical
mm-hmm.
reaction comes, because I'm in that. And there have been people at work that have seen me do this and they're like, you okay? And I'm like, yeah, I'm good. Because I'm reminding myself, don't pick it up.
Right.
Don't pick it back up.
Right.
And that's with parenting too, with things, with my marriage, with things that I
yeah.
thought I, when I realize I've picked it up, why
yes.
am I feeling this way? Because I picked it up again. Even if I'm not walking around like this.
Right.
But
yes.
I do find myself when I become aware,
yes.
I do this.
Yes.
So.
It's letting it go
and letting it go.
Trusting God.
And trusting Him.
Yeah.
But I have to connect it physically. Like there's something about feeling my hands stretch and
right.
that openness that I don't have anything in my hands. I can't hold anything if my hands are fully stretched open.
Yes.
If my fingers are all the way open.
Yes.
And I know it seems real. It's
not weird.
It's like that's... It connects, like, to feel it physically, because there's so much with God that I think, and, you know, I feel it in my heart, but I don't always, he's not tangible to me.
Yes.
Not always. He's tangible through other people. But this, I feel that.
And it's just so deep how that posture, mm-hmm. when raised, mm-hmm. then becomes, mm-hmm. you know, leads into worship.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about your childhood.
Okay.
You know, one of the things that is tough is, like, letting go of the things of our past, mm-hmm. and not allowing them to impact or influence how we live, how we see, how we parent, mm-hmm. you know?
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about your childhood, you mm-hmm. know, and how that's impacted you as a parent.
Mm-hmm. I went on quite a journey. Still am going on a journey with things that happened to me in my childhood, going into my teens, going into my 20s, and we'll stop there. No.
Right.
No. Yeah. You know.
I stopped there too.
You know, and beyond.
Yeah.
Just all the lessons that I've learned. And one of the things that really... childhood trauma is such a thing that mm-hmm. can affect you down the road,
yes.
right? And it can influence how you parent, how you walk through life. And one of the things I will say that as I got older, something that helped me heal was to realize that it goes back to what you were saying at the beginning. Wow, my parents were just doing the best they could.
Mm-hmm.
Anything that, so I can't put blame. And yes. I went through a period of that, of
yes.
putting blame and trying to figure this out. But it was all in trying to understand.
Yes.
And it's just naturally like, well, my life would have been better if this, if that, if this didn't happen, if that didn't happen. But with maturity and with time, then I realized they were, as I'm getting older and my children are getting older,
mm-hmm.
You did the best you could.
Yes.
And things that may have happened to me may not have been, it wasn't your intention for that to happen to me. So letting go of that anger helped me to heal, because things that happened to me in my childhood, like going through being molested, going mm-hmm. through abandonment, going mm-hmm. through violence, gun violence, there's drug and alcohol abuse, like growing up with all that, domestic violence, like being exposed to so murder, like being exposed to so much. I was exposed to just exposed to a lot of things.
Yeah.
Right. And it's not to any fault of my family, but that's just what my life was.
Yeah.
But you wouldn't have known it, because throughout all of it, I was joyful.
Yeah.
Like, my nature is joy.
Yeah.
So no one knew that I was, people still today don't know the things that I've gone through. We all have our stories, but people don't understand, they assume about me.
Yeah.
Like, oh, she hasn't had any hardships. I'm like, actually. But there are things that happened to me in my childhood that, as I see my kids getting older, it triggers certain memories. So
right.
I struggle with a lot of shame and things in secret for most of my life.
Mm-hmm.
The first person I told about being molested was my now husband.
Mm-hmm.
And that was at 19 years old. It was the first person I'd ever said it out loud to.
And when did it start?
Because of Karis, when she was about 2 or 3 years old, this is the answer to that question.
Yeah.
Things started to rise up in me. I started to find myself watching people with my daughter, watching things. Inside was really disturbed.
Mm-hmm.
And I would be anxious, and I would find. So that made me think that things started happening to me earlier than what I originally thought. From mm-hmm. what I remember,
Yes.
I think things started to happen because of my, like, I remember at 5 years old.
Yeah.
I remember asking my teacher a question about, oh, all sorts of things. Things that you're like, this five-year-old should not be asking me this.
Right.
But it was just innocent. Like, what does this mean? Or what does this mean? So five is what I thought, but seeing Karis and having that reaction made me realize I truly think it was earlier than what I thought.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, so seeing them grow and being triggered as they get older and older,
mm-hmm.
memories get triggered. Things I thought that I had been healed from would come up. I had gone to therapy at one point. This was like way down the road. I'd gone to therapy to be able to cope with some things, to find the words to bring up to some family members what had happened to me.
Yes.
I had been living in shame for so many years in secrecy. Now it was time to bring it to light so that I could heal. Because I was still carrying a lot. I was still carrying that shame.
Mm-hmm.
And I needed to be able to voice it.
Yes.
I needed to be able to get out of it. So by the time, let's see, because my dad was murdered when I was 11.
Mm-hmm.
So my son is 10. He's approaching 11. So that's another triggering age for me.
Yeah.
But as I see them grow, things will replay for me. So I've been able to teach them from a very young age,
mm-hmm.
body awareness,
mm-hmm.
how to be safe with their bodies, telling them the actual name of their body parts. And mm-hmm. so that way, if they ever came back and called it anything else, then mm-hmm. I knew you heard this from somewhere else because we call it what it's actually called. Your body parts are, this is what they're called.
Right.
No nicknames, nothing else. So that was my way of kind of also putting out feelers to see if, I don't like that I had to think that way, but it's how it was the result of things that had happened and things I had been exposed to. I'd been exposed to pornography at a very, very young age,
mm-hmm.
very young age. And now my kids go to school, and then at one point Declan was in second grade and I see his friends have iPhones.
Right.
My brain goes to, what are you looking at on the iPhone?
Yes.
Because you have access to the whole world. My brain goes to that because I know what I had been exposed to by second grade, by third grade. I know mm-hmm. what I had seen. Mm-hmm. So how can I shield my kids? I don't want you to see that. Okay, let's talk about it. What do you do if someone shows you something inappropriate?
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about that.
Yes.
If a friend walks over to you and says and shows you naked pictures of someone or video of someone doing something inappropriate, okay, then I had to explain, well, what is inappropriate in a very innocent way, because I also don't want to take their innocence.
Right.
But I want them to understand that it's, you know, we've talked about strangers, we talked about stranger danger. Okay, but what do you do if it's a person you know?
Exactly.
What do you do if they want to make you feel comfortable? And mm-hmm. like, who are the people who can see you naked? Mm-hmm. Okay. No one should see you naked,
mm-hmm.
but if you're at the doctor's office with mom or dad, you know, like having, so teaching them these things all along the way.
Yes.
Going all over, but it's.
No, it's really good because it even helps. These are can be hard conversations or conversations that parents even avoid.
Yeah. It's very easy to avoid it.
And I think it's good to hear how to have these conversations mm-hmm. too, you mm-hmm. know? So that your child is prepared.
And that's,
and
that's the, because I ultimately, and I tell them this so many times, I know they're sick of me saying it, but I tell them, I'm here to help you make sense of this world.
Mm-hmm.
I had to figure out a lot of things by myself
mm-hmm.
because of the secrecy, because of the shame. They don't know that part. But for me, with secrecy and shame, I had to, and then to have a parent murdered.
Yeah.
Like, there was a lot of my world that I had to figure out to make sense of. But because, again, joy is my nature, it seemed like I was fine.
Yeah.
But there was so much so much going on. And then you throw puberty in that, you know?
Right.
You know?
How did you overcome the, or heal, you know? And I know it's a journey. Mm-hmm. So I know there's still, mm-hmm. you're still on that journey.
Yeah.
But what are some steps that you've taken to along this journey of for healing from that trauma?
I'm so grateful for my husband.
Yeah.
I'm that God sent him, that we found each other.
Yes.
That he's a part of my life, because mm-hmm. that was a huge first step for me, mm-hmm. was admitting this was a secret.
Mm-hmm.
Then God used that to continue to help me through this whole journey.
Yes.
He sent a prophet, yes. into my life,
yes.
Prophet Lovi. And I call him Papa. He's like spiritual father to me, because yes. he has my earthly father, my dad, wasn't able to teach me a lot of things.
Mm.
I will tell you this. Hold on, I'm coming back.
Yeah.
I will tell you this. He told me, I do remember I was 7 years old, and he sat me down and he looked me dead in my eye, and he used to call me Turnip Green. That was his nickname, mm-hmm. for me. And all the firefighters, when they see me, they still call me Turnip Green
at
home. He was a firefighter. So he looked me dead in my eye, and he was like, Turnip Green, not everybody's going to like you. Not everybody's going to be your friend.
Mm.
Like, he was very, mm-hmm. like, so those type of lessons I got, like, he would teach me those things.
What was your relationship like with him?
It was a very interesting relationship. It was a very confusing relationship.
Mm-hmm.
He dealt with a lot of, now that I'm older to be able to look back, to realize he was dealing with a lot of demons.
Mm-hmm.
He was dealing with a lot of, hardships. He was a very secretive man.
Mm-hmm.
I know I learned at some point he saw a lot of trauma and violence.
Mm-hmm.
But I learned that like bits and pieces. He was a very complicated man.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew he loved me.
Yes.
But then even then it was complicated, because it was confusing. Touch became a very confusing thing,
mm-hmm.
with him.
Mm-hmm.
And he dealt with a lot of demons, but through it all, I was always proud of him.
Yeah.
And he was always proud of me, and he would, you know, like, I knew he was the one who would just tell me like it was.
Mm-hmm.
My mom, she's great. She's, I still have my mom. She supports me. She loves me. Oh my gosh. She is my biggest champion. Mm-hmm. Always has been. Moms carry a lot.
Yes.
They carry a lot.
Yeah.
So she's a business professional, or, well, at that time she was, she was in education. She had moved up pretty far through education. She was going to school.
Mm-hmm.
She's carrying a lot. She's volunteering at church. She's all these responsibilities, plus being the mom of the house, you know? So when moms are busy doing all their things, and dads are able to, you know, sometimes just have more fun, or they don't have to carry as much. I'm not saying they don't work hard. I'm not saying they're not involved, mm-hmm. but there's a different dynamic.
Yeah.
So things that she would advise me on would be different than what he would.
Right.
You know,
right.
It may not have occurred to her to say, not everybody's going to like you. She's like, oh, you're great. You know, mm-hmm. she was always encouraging,
mm-hmm.
but, and still is, but he would look. And I think that may be part of where I get that from my kids.
Mm-hmm.
And I tell them, look, not everybody's going to be your friend.
Yes.
Not everybody's going to like you.
Yes.
What is that going to do for you? And to hear their reactions, Karis is like, that's okay. And
I can see her.
She's like, that's okay. And Declan's like, okay. Like, to see him like, okay, good. Because, you know, mm-hmm. people will, if they can hurt you, they will.
Mm-hmm.
And it sounds so bleak sometimes. And I don't mean it from that point. But I just want to be real with them. I don't want to sugarcoat the world.
Yeah.
You know? And then they get out from under us. And then they're like, you didn't tell me this is what, you know.
And it's just like one of those things where you can, your faith and everybody's going to make a mistake.
Yeah.
The only person, God is the only one who is blameless.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, he's the only one.
And so it's like, it's just kind of, I think it's navigating to that. It's like, people are people.
Yes.
We're all going to make mistakes.
We're all going to make mistakes.
You know? And even as a parent, there are times when I will unintentionally hurt you.
Yes.
You know, it's not my intention.
Right.
You know?
Right.
But you know who you can always lean on.
Yeah, exactly.
No matter what.
No matter what.
You know, who always has your best interest.
Yes.
You know, no yeah. matter what.
Yeah.
That's really powerful.
Mm-hmm.
Really mm-hmm. powerful.
So to have someone to teach me about worldly things, and then yes. I have, like I mentioned, my spiritual father,
yes,
my papa, he to teach me spiritual things and to care, to teach me more about the relationship with God, and
yes.
and God really used him to help heal me and deliver me and help me process right. this trauma and how to give it to him and to understand that it wasn't, to give it to God
yeah.
and to understand that it wasn't anything I did. That was another mm-hmm. thing. That was another thing. It wasn't anything I did.
Yes.
But this was something that happened. But through it, I'm able to be this type of mom to my children.
Mm-hmm.
I'm able to teach them in a way that, like I said, I never want them to feel like they're processing this world alone. And I'm not saying like I couldn't have talked to my mom about these things. I just didn't know how to.
Right.
And it wasn't until years later going to therapy, I got the tools. Mm-hmm. This is before I met Prophet Lovie. Like I got the tools to be able to have that one conversation.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, let me just tell you. Okay, now I can process this spiritually.
Yes.
And heal in a deeper way. And now I am a better mom
mm-hmm.
as a result of it. Because if I was still carrying this stuff, if I was still as bruised and shame-filled as I once was, I don't know what kind of a mom I would have been able to yeah. have been to them.
Yeah.
I have a glimpse of it because, I mean, when we first moved here, when we first moved to LA, they were 1 and 2.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
No one else here, just, you know,
yes.
just us, and, you know, depression really kicked in mm-hmm. and, those thoughts were starting to just get louder and louder mm-hmm. of all the things I was doing wrong. My patience was wearing thin. I've got these two babies. I'm by myself. How am I expected to do anything? Oh, and then you want me to go to, then I'm trying to do auditions. No one knows I'm here if I'm only, no, the casting directors, no one knows I'm here if I'm just in the apartment taking care of these babies. Like then beating myself up and just
right.
getting down and down and down and down and then still dealing with that. The trauma, still dealing with like all the things that we carry, all the things that we internalize. Mm-hmm. But then once I was shown how to surrender it, to let it go.
Yes.
And really give it to God and to understand what that really looks like.
Yes.
And there are days I still will get triggered here and there when yeah. I'm like, oh, I'm good. I'm in a good place. There was a day where we couldn't find Karis on campus
mm-hmm.
and because parents aren't allowed to be on campus right now because of everything with COVID and my immediate thought was, where's that one coach that's always aware of where she is?
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't, where's that one coach so I could ask him? It's, where is he?
Yes.
Is he with Karis?
Yes.
He's been giving her candy lately, her and her little friends, but what, Denisha, no, relax.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You've taught her.
Mm-hmm.
She knows what to look for.
Yes.
She's a smart girl. She's safe. Her brother is there. Like I had to de-escalate. God's in control. I had to de-escalate yeah. myself.
Yes.
Because as much of this process as I've gone through, it can pop back up and I have
right.
to remind myself, nope, we're protected.
Yes.
It ended with you.
Yes.
That trauma is not going to go beyond. It's
yes.
never going to happen again. I'm not going to allow it. And
yes.
And I have to
surrender that. Yes.
Surrender it and have to breathe. And then it just turned out she was in the computer lab, you
right.
know? That's
right.
That's it. She was just in the computer lab.
But what you're saying is so real. And for many people in different situations, and I've experienced it myself where, you know, thoughts,
oh my gosh,
chatter will come
so fast,
so quickly, and you gotta throw them things out.
Yes,
you know.
Yes, yes.
But you have to recognize it mm-hmm. as an enemy. Mm-hmm. You know, so you have to recognize, like, no, this is not my thought.
Yes.
This is not what God has said over this situation.
Yes.
This is what He has said.
Yes.
You know, and cast it out, mm-hmm. you know, and what you just said is how we do that. It's literally how you speak to yourself mm-hmm. in that moment, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. you don't allow it to stay mm-hmm. and you surrender it. And also, as you talked about your healing and deliverance.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just an amazing vessel that God has used in your life and my life too, you know. It's literally allowed the room when what I experienced for myself is literally, it was like I dealt with guilt and shame, you know. I dealt with all of that, and how when one, it's just a lie. Mm-hmm. Those things are a lie. It's a mm-hmm. way to separate us from God, where we literally separate ourselves yeah. from Him because we're holding on to those things.
Yeah.
And, but when once we're free of that, you know, God's love comes in.
Yeah.
And His love, it does cast out all fear.
It does.
You know?
Yes.
And so even in those moments, I realize, like, when I'm afraid, like, oh, I need more of Your love, Lord. I thought I knew it. I need some more.
Yeah. Yeah.
You
Please,
know?
So can I have some more?
Can I have some more?
Yeah.
You know, and I think it's so beautiful. Just the journey that you're on. It's not perfect. It's not pretty. Mm-mm. But it's the greatest because it has gotten you to where you are. And it has allowed for you to have this intimacy with God that's different.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And you are an overcomer, you know?
Amen.
And I'm curious, what does intimacy look like for you now with God? Because one of the things that I realized that has been a challenge is, as being a mom now, especially to a toddler, mm-hmm. you know, and going through the baby phase, is just having that time.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. that I was used to really letting go of that, what it looked like,
yeah.
you know, but what does day to day, what does intimacy look like with you, with God?
It's so I've learned to create that space even when they're around, even when the kids are around. And this is what I mean.
That's good.
I would just be walking around praying out loud or just talking.
Yeah, me too. Yeah.
And they would be like, what? Oh, she's talking to God.
Yes.
It's become so normal.
Yes.
That they, it's like there are times where, like, this is the only time I, yeah. like, Lord, and I will just talk to Him.
Yes.
So now I have the time where I take them to school and then I can have the time in the car. But I have to be intentional mm-hmm. because I miss Him. I miss Him when I can feel it when I haven't spent time with Him.
Yes.
And as I'm getting older, realizing how much I really need Him. Mm-hmm. And then there's this app on my phone, you may have it. It's, or Google does it. Like all these, they're like these little memory apps that will, here's what happened a year ago today, or here's what happened 2 years ago today.
Yeah.
You know, and it'll show you the
absolutely.
Pictures from all that.
Absolutely.
So this is kind of what happens is as I'm growing in Him, I'm starting to recognize, similar as when I was able to recognize that my parents were doing the best they could in hindsight, I'm able to look back and be like, oh, you cared for me there too.
That's so good.
You were with yeah. that little girl. So much mm-hmm. healing has happened with this inner. We hold on to, my opinion, there's this inner child, this inner girl. Mm-hmm. And it took a while for me to realize that inner child was, she was buried, she was hunched over in a corner, just sad all the time mm-hmm. is how I felt. And God, you cared about, he's healed that little girl. Like he's gone back in time mm. to heal. It's what I feel like he's, it seems like the more I grow with him going forward, the more I'm able to see he's gone back and has healed that little girl who was still, I was still holding on to her, but she was back there. This sounds like some real multiverse type thing, but he's healed. As he's healing me going forward, he's providing healing to back then. And the more intimate I'm growing with him now, he's showing me that he was there with me there, and that intimacy was there then. And so now, like, she's good.
Yes.
Like, that inner child, I no longer, like, oh, that inner child, that little girl from that time, from that time in my mind, from that memory that I recall, that those feelings that came up with her, she's good.
Yeah.
She's healed. That memory of who I was, of that little girl, of me at that age, is good. So it makes me more in love with him, more of, wow, you are, you did take care of me. You did love me because you're loving me now, which shows me that you were loving me then. And it just makes me love him more and want to spend more time with him and want to find that time more to be more mindful. I was making salads at work. I was covering for someone on a shift and I was making salads. And I just got a wave of thinking about him. And we were wearing masks. So I was able to just talk and nobody knew I was talking. Because nobody could see my mouth.
Yeah.
And I'm just talking to him and started crying. And I had to leave because, you know, food safety. I don't want to be crying.
Crying in the salad.
So I had to leave. Yeah. I had to step away. And so finding moments to just make him a part of my life, because it's, I'm not necessarily going to have like a full hour. I'm not an early person.
Right.
I'm not the one that's going to wake up at 5 a.m. to spend time with God. Lord bless the people who are able to do that. I recognize I'm not wired that way. Don't feel like rewiring to make myself that way. It's like, that's okay. But I do need to be intentional with spending my time with him.
Absolutely.
So it's finding those times and realizing, like, even if it's not 3 hours,
right,
if it's 5 minutes of genuine attention to him, and I'm not asking him for anything, but I just want to sit with him, just want to sit, and we're talking, just settle in.
Yes,
you know,
absolutely.
Just settle into him. Absolutely. If it was just for 5 minutes, I want that.
Yes.
And the more I do that, the more I can function and be a better mom and a better wife. And
that's so good. Now, what is joy to you?
What is joy to me? For me, it's not happiness. Joy and happiness are separate. It is, what is joy? I'm sounding so cheesy, but it's like sunshine. It's like sunshine that's inside, that's just always beaming out, that you can't, that it's just a sunny day is the best way I could describe it. But an internal sunny day.
I think that's great. Yeah,
it's the best way I could describe it.
And I see that. Like, and you carry that.
Oh,
you are. Like,
thank you.
One of the things that I think that's a beautiful image and that I think is part of it is that it doesn't matter what the weather is outside or around them, that you carry that sunny day inside of you. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I think that is what joy is.
Yeah.
And that's how joy versus happiness. Happiness is based on, oh, it's sunny outside, so I can be sunny.
Yes.
You know? But joy is that it can be raining, it could be, it might be sunny, it might be cloudy, it might be whatever, but I'm carrying the sunshine.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because my mom always told me, you know, especially when I first moved to LA and the times were rough, and she's like, baby, you got to find the joy in the journey. You know, there's always joy in the journey. And then Brandon's mother one of the things that she would say is that you find the J in joy every day. Mm. And for her, the J was Jesus.
Mm.
So every day she has this opportunity to find the J in joy. And yeah. her relationship with Christ is what allowed her to know that joy.
Yes.
Every single day.
Yes.
And I think it's so important because we hear so many conversations about happiness. But I think what is so important for us, you know, as moms, is to carry joy.
Yes.
It doesn't matter what's going on around us.
Mm-mm.
It doesn't matter what, you know, might have happened yesterday mm-hmm. or in the next moment, yeah. you know. But we have this assurance that comes with knowing our Father.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what brings joy.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And it can't be shaken by circumstances.
Yeah.
By what goes right or what goes wrong. And I think it's so beautiful. It's such a beautiful thing to hold on to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it and is. To know.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And it's interesting that you said that as a child, you had joy.
Yeah.
So in spite yeah. of the what was yeah. happening, that's deep.
Yes.
That's it's, deep.
I, no matter how awful things got, and I had a beautiful family. I still have, yes. I have a beautiful family and it's grounded. Our family is grounded in love
mm-hmm.
and God, and we all grew up in church, and like it's a solid foundation. It's just a lot of bumps along the way, but through it all, man, I was joyful.
Yeah.
Joy, 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 joy down in my heart. You know, like yeah. singing that in children's choir. Like yeah. that was true.
Yeah.
Down in my heart. Yeah. You know, that was who I was.
Mm-hmm.
Still am to this day because I thank God, I praise Him so much. Like, good Lord, you kept me.
Mm.
Oh, man. I very easily,
yeah.
oh my gosh, yeah. I could have very easily have gone
yeah.
many different directions
yes.
and no one would have faulted me for
yes.
it. It would have, I had every thing checked on this card that had been like, oh yeah, that makes sense. Oh yeah, that explains it.
Mm-hmm.
I would have had so much grace to be,
mm-hmm.
to have lost my mind. It
mm-hmm.
would have made so much sense.
Mm-mm-mm.
But to be this to be at peace,
man.
To have forgiveness
yes.
for people who hurt me,
yes.
to have to be like, you know, it's okay.
Yes.
That was, you know, it was. I know who God is. I know
yes.
what Jesus has done for me.
Yes.
But oh my gosh, I could have so easily,
yes.
so easily, have gone way off the rails.
Yes.
And, you know, of course, in times in college, I tried to go off the rails. And then yeah. God's like, hey, let me bring you up.
Right.
Chris, come here.
Right. Chris, come on. I got a plan and a purpose for her life.
Like,
and
I need you to please enter now.
Right. I love that.
She's trying
it. The story of how you guys met just
yeah.
melts my heart. Melts yes. my heart. It's so yeah. wonderful.
Yeah.
How he was playing on a worship band.
And yeah. And
and you just walked,
walked in
into the room.
I literally busted in the room like, yeah. hey guys,
what you doing?
I really did.
Yeah.
Can I join in? Like, hi. And it was a group of friends and several of us are still friends, but Chris was a part of that.
Yeah.
And we've been Chris and Denisha ever since. Like, and,
yes.
and, but that was how I was led to,
mm-hmm.
to even go there. That's how I know, like, God, you've been with me
yes.
every step of the way,
yes.
every
yes.
step of the way, every step of things that happened to me in my childhood, the confusing time of teenage years, going into college, revealing that I need to get free of this. So
mm-hmm.
let's start. Hey, let's
mm-hmm.
start the clock on. I need you to start the clock on this shame thing.
Yeah.
Because I got two other little humans that I am. We're bringing through the two of you.
Yeah.
And I need you to be healed. I need you to be on your way to be healed by then
yes.
because of what their destiny is.
Absolutely.
And it's like having an idea of I feel like I'm carrying royalty. There's something special about Karis and Deck. There's something here. They have destiny. Mm-hmm. Let me get my stuff together. Mm-hmm. Let me figure out more of what you have for me. Let me open my eyes to this healing. Let me not slow myself down by holding on to that trauma and holding on to this bruised little girl who was once there. Yeah. I need to get rid of this. I need to process this. I need to pay attention to what you're telling me, what you're, the people you've put in my life to encourage me, to teach me, to mentor, like everyone's point. I need to get a hold of this for them.
Right.
And for beyond them.
Yes.
Not saying I have more children, but but before, beyond. Oh, let me clarify.
Like, don't get excited.
Let me clarify. For their children, like my grandchildren and generations beyond. It's like, it's, and when we realize, I think when we wake up and we can see, oh my gosh, it's so much bigger than just little old me. Mm-hmm. You know, it's so much big. You have so much, because you even look back at all the people who've come before us.
Yes.
They, that took for us to get here. I can't drop the baton.
Yes.
I can't afford to close myself off and just sit in this bubble and only focus on the pain and the past. I can't because there's too much.
Yes.
There's too much at stake.
Yes.
There's too much at stake for me not to speak to my children in a way that points them to Jesus. There's too much at stake for me not to be able to humble myself before them. There's too much at stake.
Yes.
So that's what keeps pushing me, you know?
What would you say to someone who is either a mom now, mm-hmm. Or... you know, preparing for motherhood, who has stuff from their past that they haven't dealt with, whether it be trauma, you know, guilt, shame. And what would you say to that person who may be afraid or not know how to take some of the steps that you have?
I would say it's time to be brave.
Mm-hmm.
It's time to be brave.
Mm-hmm.
It's time to say no more. I'm not gonna, mm-hmm. I refuse to let that rob me of my future.
Mm.
I refuse to let someone else's demons rob me of what God has for me in my life.
Mm-hmm.
That's the point you have to get to, and you have to be brave to do it. Mm-hmm. Like, it's, you have to not care. I had to go to therapy to be able to talk to my mom about what happened to me.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew I couldn't hold on to it anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like you be brave and do it.
Yeah.
Because there's too much at stake not to.
Yeah.
And if it's finding a therapist, if it's finding a person you trust, if it's your pastor, if it's a counselor, if it's I thank God so much for Prophet Lovie. If it's someone, start peeling back the layers. Back at 19 years old, it started with me just, can I trust Chris with this?
Mm-hmm.
But this was a person that I knew I loved.
Yeah.
Started with just trusting one person.
Yes.
To just say it out loud.
Yes.
But it's that's what I would say.
Yeah.
You have to.
Yeah.
You have to.
Can we actually pray for those who are in that position right now? Mm-hmm. Can you pray for them?
Yes.
Yeah.
God, thank you so much. You are such a good God. You are an amazing, amazing Father.
Yes,
how
yes.
much you love us. God, you loved us first. Those daughters that are yours, God, that are hurting, Father, I speak healing over them. Go to those deep places, God, in their heart. Go to those deep places in their soul. Those places, those secret places that no one knows about. Those dark places that they've been holding on to. Those secrets they've been holding on to, that shame that they've been carrying, God, I speak to that. We cancel it. We put it at your feet, Jesus. We put it at your feet. Go to them, God.
Yes.
heal them, send people into their lives that can encourage and that can lift them up safely. I just speak peace over them, peace over my sisters, peace and healing over them, God. I thank you for the testimonies that are going to come out of their lives, that as they take each step forward, it may be scary, it may be shaky each step, but that they get stronger with every step into the light that they take.
Amen.
Every step in the light that they take towards you, God, every little step that they take, that you're strengthening them and you're lifting them up. And I thank you for the healing, and I thank you for the peace, and I thank you for the testimony that's going to come from them.
Yes.
I thank you for the stories, and that as they heal, that they will be able to help others, that they will be able to heal others, that they can be able to look back and say, I've overcome this. You can too.
Lord,
I went through this. You can come through it too. I thank you that you are such a good God. I praise you for what you are going to do, what you will continue to do. Not only in my life, in my sister Jamila's life, but everyone who's watching, anyone that this can touch, God. I thank you, Father, and we worship you.
Yes. In Jesus' name.
Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, thank you. I love you so much.
Thank you. I love you too.
Thank you for everything you poured out. Thank you for your transparency.
Yeah.
Thank you for your love. Thank you for it all. I adore you.
I adore you too. Thank you for this opportunity.
Absolutely.
Because it's like, it's one of those things, like, I mean, the devil even tried it again, and I was sexually assaulted in college, you know, like, how do you also process that?
Yes.
Is it me? Am I doing this? Like, how, this is before I met Chris, you know, like, what?
Yeah.
I mean, gosh, that all of those things, all the things the devil tried, because he knew.
He did.
He knew what was was for me.
Exactly.
He knew. So anything he could do to derail, okay, she seems to be, that didn't knock her off, that didn't knock her off, that didn't knock her off. Okay, let's try this one more thing.
Yes.
And that could have totally taken me away from my opportunity to meet Chris.
Yeah.
Like, what a, so choosing who we partner with is so important.
That's huge.
It is so, it's not just, oh, he's cute or she's cute. Oh, it's, no, there's purpose. So him bringing us together there's purpose in that.
Yes.
And out of that, we've got Declan and Karis, you know, like there's purpose in that union.
But it's so interesting, even you having the courage to open up to him.
Yeah.
After so much had happened.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
For you to open and allow him in. And so many people, because of their experience, become very guarded.
Mm-hmm.
And God can send them someone.
Yeah.
But the fear of being hurt can keep them from allowing, you know, that person in.
Yeah.
But it took courage for you, you know, to actually let your guard down.
Mm-hmm.
But it also, you know, knowing your husband, he carries the love of Christ.
Yes, he does.
It's in his DNA.
It
like,
is.
It's just like,
it
so
really is.
I think it's so beautiful that you recognized it. even if you didn't know what to call it, your spirit was like, oh.
Yeah.
This is a safe space, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And think of in the purpose, like he said, it's so interesting to me how such pain can lead to the greatest purpose, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And how many people God is using you for to set free, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Through just sharing, through your books, through just the light that you carry, that sunshine that's inside of you, you know?
Yeah.
That joy that is not anchored in what went right, but in who is the center of your life.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And I so glad you just said that, because it's real. Who you partner with.
Yes. Yes.
He was so instrumental in your healing.
Yeah, he really was.
is so key. Mm-hmm. It's so funny because we had finished, like, right. But right, it's like, right, there's more.
There's more.
There's yeah. so much.
Yeah.
It's so deep.
Mm-hmm.
Man, thank you for sharing so much.
Oh,
why else?
What else would it have been for?
Mm-hmm.
If, and that goes to speak to how much I trust God.
Yes.
Jesus, you are so a part of my life that I can trust you that I went through this.
Mm-hmm.
You wouldn't let me go through this
mm-hmm.
for nothing.
Yes.
You will be glorified through this.
Yes. Amen.
All of that is to bring him glory.
Amen.
And if, and, but it takes perspective change.
Yeah.
It takes a shift.
Yes.
To be able to say, it's not just, oh, why did all this happen to me? Like, yeah. you know, which I went through that.
Yeah.
But there's so much more. If we can step out, what, you know, mm-hmm. Jesus died on the cross, you know, all that he went through,
yeah.
you know,
yeah.
for what? Do we focus on the pain and the physical pain that his body went through and all the humiliation? Do we focus on that because we could?
Right.
We could just focus on that.
Yeah.
Or do we focus on what came out of him dying on the cross and what that meant
yes.
for all of us?
Yes.
Ultimately for us to have a relationship with God.
Yes.
To open that door. So yes. I can't just focus on, but I did. For a period of time,
mm-hmm.
but over time, I started to understand, all things mm-hmm. work together for the, all things?
Mm-hmm.
All things work yeah. together for the good.
Yeah.
And when I go through those lists, I'm like, even this, even that, how was that? Oh, because I can talk to someone about pornography addiction. I can yeah. talk to someone about gun violence. Yeah. I can talk to someone about suicidal attempts. Like
yeah.
to be a child and to hold a loaded gun to my head and think, should I pull the trigger or not? A child dealing with suicidal thoughts that no one knew
because
I was like, oh no, I don't need that.
Yeah.
Like the choice was made and then yeah. I moved on.
Yes.
You know, like there's a lot. Yeah. All things.
Yeah.
Yeah. All of that. All things work together for the good. So God, every bit of craziness
yeah.
that I went through, every, and that's the thing.
Yeah.
You look at me and it's like,
you don't know what someone's going through.
We don't know what people are going through. So no. What an opportunity for us to always share love with each other because yeah. you don't know what people have gone through. You,
yeah.
We can't judge people on mm-mm. things that they've gone through or what if they are shameful or if it's taken them longer to bring things up. We just don't know what they've gone
yeah.
through or where they are in their journey of healing or they're not ready to talk about it now. But in a couple of years, this is going to be a huge testimony.
Yes.
See what God's going to do with
yes.
that. They're still cooking. You
yeah,
know,
yeah,
they're yeah. still being put together, but
and I think for what you're saying is so important because mm-hmm. a lot of people, some people don't make it past the pain.
Yeah, it can be really yeah. overwhelming.
They you know we are there are alarming rates of people taking their lives mm-hmm. or you know or even just. You know, not living anymore. You're yeah. here, but you're not living.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And I think what you're saying is that it's so important for those to hear who are in the midst of that pain. There's another side to it.
There's another side.
And God will not only heal you of that,
mm-hmm.
but he will use you for good.
Mm-hmm.
And there's more. There's more.
Yeah.
There's more. There is a purpose to your life. There
yes.
has been a plan the
yes,
entire
the
time.
Entire time.
The entire time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that there is more yeah. that he's going to do and reveal through you.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yes.
And I think that's so important, you know, because everybody don't make it past the pain. There are a lot
that's
of
true.
God's precious children who do not make it past the pain. And that nothing else. To someone who's listening right now, who yeah. is in the midst of their pain, know that there is more.
Yep.
more that God has more in store.
Just hold on. It's yeah. almost like I can hear him saying, baby girl, just hold on a little longer.
Yeah. Yes.
Just
you are a living, walking testimony that God's promises are real.
Yes.
They are true.
Yes.
And what he has on the other side is so much greater.
Yes.
It can get better.
It can get so much better.
Sweeter.
So much sweeter.
And you are an example of that. You are proof of that.
Yep.
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 Amen.
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 Oh my gosh.
I love you so much.
Oh, I love you too. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh my goodness.